Hello. Welcome, Oakleigh's rock god, the Greek community rock star. We have wogatized you, but you're still our Aussie rock star. Jimmy Cupples, welcome to the KK Factor, Rhythmos 1656.
Thank you so much for having me. I'll tell you what, though, I can smell the Greek desserts.
Can you?
Yeah, because I know that there's a little place next door full of them.
And your favourite drinks there too.
Baklava and a little bit of...
Baklava.
Baklava, is it?
Yeah, baklava.
Yeah, I've never been able to pronounce things properly. And the vodka, the Russian vodka. Anyway, shouldn't be talking about that right now. How are you?
I'm good, Jimmy, I'm good. What's it like for you to be back in Oakleigh?
It's great. It's like a blast from the past. It wasn't that long ago I was leaving here at 2 and 3 in the morning.
After you rock everybody. I know. The mall was always alive back then.
Oh, it was a pretty bizarre gig down there with Andrew Koikas and Evropides and the guys.
I know.
Singing A Whole Lot of Love and Rock and Roll and Deep Purple. And
well, we don't have the Vanilla House Band anymore because no Jimmy Cupples, no Vanilla House Band.
No.
Do we think but we might see days. You in the future, do you reckon? Do you reckon you'll come back here?
Well, I don't know. They'd have to twist my arm and give me a few more.
You're a big star now, Greek but desserts. You know. I think we could try something to
That's
get you back.
That's all it takes is a few Greek desserts.
And the Russian vodka.
Not to mention the rock and vodka. That's true. We love our vodka.
How's the voice? How is the voice?
My voice is good.
Yeah?
Yeah, I've been taking it easy and... I actually had something very special done to my voice recently.
Did you?
Yeah, I stopped drinking alcohol for about a week.
I like it. I like
it. No, I'm in good voice at the moment, so really? I'm happy about that. Of course, when I did when I was on telly, doing the telly
voice.
Show,
The Voice. Because this song was from The Voice.
That was live from The Voice, and I got quite sick towards the end of that show, and actually.
You actually sounded fantastic.
Yeah, I don't know why it sounded like that. Maybe people like the extra husky bits. But yeah. I got a hernia, a hiatus hernia from working out in the gym.
And really?
Yeah, because I was in Sydney and there wasn't time to be sent to hospitals and get x-rays and all the rest of it. So no one knew. When I got back here, I did all the tests and thought, oh, no wonder I had all this acid in my mouth. And,
oh, my goodness.
And it was burning my vocal cords. So I had to go on a bit of a health course. And now I'm eating completely different foods. And I'm not really drinking alcohol at all now because years ago I'd say, oh, yeah, I'll have a scotch before I start. It's just to rest.
Warm you
to
up a little bit.
Just to feel a bit relaxed. But the problem is now that just sends up all the acid reflux coming up, you see. So
if I tell you, if I asked you now to do a little bit of that woman with your
Don't know if I could, not warmed up. Takes a lot to do that.
Oh.
Yeah, that's like about a half an hour vocal warm-up before I went on telly to do that.
Oh, well, maybe you can sing in between and then we can get a bit of a live.
Okay, baby, yeah.
That's pretty good. Keep going a little bit more.
All right, KkRock Chic, you're looking good tonight.
Oh, my goodness. Do you know what? You would make a great person. You know how to do those pre-recording audio things, but you never know what I might get out of you tonight.
I used to do a lot of that in the 90s.
Did you?
Down at Metropolis Studios in Port Melbourne there.
Uh-huh.
With the old Mike Brady and Doug Brady and good fun days.
Uh-huh.
Yeah.
Tell me about The Voice. Now, I know from an audience perspective, it looked great. Mm-hmm. What actually went behind the scenes? And I want to touch about Job, but not just yet, but I want to talk about Seal because we heard something on the radio about Seal and I thought, oh, that's going to touch a nerve. What was that all about?
It was a funny one. Unbeknownst to me that I heard about this from later on one of the contestants, who was the second one in the top five, told me that... he looked at me as a bit of a threat to Krikellis because Krikellis was on his team. And it's funny because we were completely different singers, so I didn't see the sense in being paranoid. So he didn't really want me to be there for too long because, considering me some sort of a threat was, I thought, bizarre anyway, but he did. So he came into the studio and I was very, very sick, so they sent me home early, but they made me do my rehearsal earlier for Sweet Child of Mine, and he came in later expecting to see me there, got half the story and run with it on telly.
Oh.
And said, that was a great performance, Jimmy, but it's hard for me to give it up to you because you weren't at the rehearsal. Why? And I said, well, I was really sick. And I let it go. And then I realized, oh, he just bamboozled me into saying I was really sick.
But when he also...
What I should have said was, well, I actually was there, just not when you turned up.
Oh, whoopsie.
But you see, so... and then, of course, I thought, well, I could go in now. But I'm kind of... people that know me know I'm a gentle kind of a guy. So I didn't want to start fighting on telly.
But he also... he said that you had an attitude. How did you feel about that one?
Well, you've got to have an attitude. To get up, when I went on The Voice, on the live audience performances, why did they ask me to open the show?
Yeah, good question.
Mm. You know what? I think if you've got an attitude, the attitude, what he meant by that was, why are you so confident? You know, confident in a positive way, but not confident in a negative way.
Do you think maybe Seal was felt threatened for himself?
Oh, I don't think so. No, I don't. I don't think so. There's no need for that. I wasn't in a competition against him. I think he's a guy that wants to win, you know. And when there's Joel's team and Keith's team and Delta's team, I think he wants to win. So he'll do anything to create doubt for the other contestants. But the show has changed now. If you've been watching The Voice now, I think they've ironed out all the sort of politics and psychology of it a bit
more team playing now.
Now it's all team playing. Oh yeah, Delta, what a great choice. And now they're all being really positive and being really nice.
Are they, or is it a performance? Because at the end of the day, The Voice still is a show.
It's
and
a
they
show.
Have to maintain their ratings.
They do. And like all those shows, look, I think The Voice was an honest show when it's a blind audition, when the judges aren't seeing the act, when they only judge a person on their voice, that's when it's the true voice. But once it's over to the public, naturally the public are going to pick the guy that looks like Elvis or the girl that looks like, you know, Mariah Carey. So that's what happens. It all becomes... And who you get to see the most of when they're on there. I didn't get a spread in TV week. Some of them had a big spread in TV week right after their performance.
But you got a spread in Opera magazine.
But that's the media.
Yeah.
So when you're giving some the opportunity to be seen by the whole of Australia in a magazine, like I won't mention the name of it, people are going to go, oh, yeah, I really like this. But they're going to get more of a liking to that person. So they've... That sort
well, the
of thing
media
happens.
Does play a big
and
role.
And it's not The Voice's fault either, because the voice would say, we're going to have this artist, we're going to have all the artists from The Voice taking a big picture, and then next day, 2 days later, they see that the people that turned up with the magazine have only shot the picture of the one person. They don't have the control over that.
No, they don't.
So suddenly that one person gets more likes and more people liking them. So it is a TV show, you're right, and they want to sell, they want people to like the show.
And they need the ratings. Well, you know what? We are going to talk about you being a daddy.
Yeah.
Straight after Sweet Child of Mine.
Thank you. She's got a smile and it seems to me reminds me of childhood memories when everything was as fresh as a bright blue sky. Special place. If I stay too long, I'll probably break down and cry. Whoa, whoa, sweet child of mine. Whoa, whoa, sweet love of mine. Yeah.
And a big hello goes out to Eva Sakelakis, Mark Cannon, Vicky Theodosiou, Steve Alley and Andrea. And Angela, big hello, and Dez. Don't worry, Eleanor, I haven't forgotten about you. And a big hello also goes out to George. Okay, darling, I missed your phone call, but a big hello goes out to you as well. And that was Jimmy Cupples, Sweet Child of Mine. Yes, and we have Jimmy Cupples in the studio this evening on Rhythmor 1656, the KK Factor. Jimmy, do you consider yourself a committed family man?
Definitely. I definitely need to be committed.
How many children have you got?
Committed
four, five,
to,
ten?
Committed to an asylum. No, four children that I know of.
That
no,
you
no,
know
four. I've been a good boy all my life. Four children.
Yeah, I've been doing research. I've been trying to find some
bad stuff on you.
It's been hard work.
There'll be plenty of that, I bet you.
A few people have told me you've knocked back things.
Knocked back, yeah.
Things, yeah, because you're a committed father. Mm-hmm. Do you want to tell me a little bit about that?
Yeah, oh, through the years. But I've only knocked them back for the right reasons. I've always been, when I went to the States 23 years ago, we went to perform for Sony Records, and I always wanted to sing. I've always wanted to sing rock, and everybody's always tried to tell me to sing something else. So back then, we were met up with some management and some different people, DreamWorks and Sony Records, and they said, Jimmy, can we make you, what about being more of a Green Day kind of a type of thing? And I was always... It was a really hard thing. Someone would wave a carrot in front of you and say, well, here it is. You can have the carrot, but you've got to change into pink clothes. Or you've got to...
I have seen you
well,
in pink
that's probably
too.
Not a good scenario.
I have got a photo of you in one of them.
Yeah, but, you know, the whole thing of being something you're not just actually really scares the hell out of me. There's enough of that around these days. Why would you want to be? Why would you want to run away from being what you are? So I just need to, really. In the past, I've always met the wrong people, and maybe it's the best thing that could have happened because you know, if I had have gone that way, maybe my life would be not as good,
not as good,
not as fulfilled right now. You know.
Well, you definitely do look fulfilled. I have met your adorable and committed wife.
Mm.
And I've seen a couple of your kids, but we saw all of them on live screen.
Uh-huh.
How do you balance your life with gigs, children, and you have got a partner?
Well, it's really, really hard because, you know, I am a committed father. Every night I do a gig, I go home to the one I love, and then I go see the wife.
And then
no, kidding. When I get up in the morning...
Spiking like a rock star.
I get up about you know, 6 o'clock every morning. And then I go to my gigs, and some of them, you know, I'm home at 2:30 in the morning, 3 in the morning.
So do you think you put enough time in to help with the responsibilities of raising children?
Yeah, that's why I get up at 6, because, you know, there's the little ones, got to get their breakfast, got to get them dressed, do their hair, drop them off at school, kinder and school. The older boys are at that age now, 15 and 18, where they look after themselves, basically. You know, I just drop them off at the bus stop. They get the bus to school, and that's pretty easy.
And Kelly also studies.
Kylie's studying now.
Oh, Kylie, sorry.
Art teacher. She's been working at schools and doing extremely well, actually. So I get the dinners ready. I pick them all up. Kinder at 12:15, school at 3:15. The boys get home. I pick them up at the bus stop from where they go to school down in Werribee, MacKillop, great school. And by then I've already been to the supermarket to organise what's going to be for
dinner.
That's
amazing, because no one visualises a singer, a rock star doing all that. Normally there's nannies running around or whatever, or he's never home, he's always on tours.
Yeah.
And I know that you have sung with some big names, Jimmy Barnes.
Yeah.
That's why I'm trying to work out how you have created this family life, and it is a happy family life, and you've maintained your singing career, and Kylie also studies.
Mm. Yeah. Yeah, it's I guess when you're in it, it doesn't seem – it's like anybody. It's like any mother, any father that go out and work. When you sit down on the couch and have a cup of tea at the end of the night, you go – oh my God, how did I get through that day? And most of us live that life. And I guess when you're in it, you just seem to be able to do it. Goodness gracious, when you're out of it, it must seem like a terribly hard chore, you know. But when you're in it, all those good parents, you know, the average Australian does it every day. It's no big deal.
The only
hard part is that I've got to go out at night and come home.
Yeah, that's exactly right. And then you've got to get up nice and early in the morning.
Yeah, yeah.
So tell me some big names that you have gigged with.
Oh, look, Deep Purple. It's one of the biggest bands up there with, you know, Zeppelin and all that. Through the years, Australian artists like James Rain and Deborah Byrne and Peter Cupples, my cousin. I've done a lot of gigs with him. We did backup vocals with Ross Wilson one night, and he came out and did Eagle Rock and Come, Said the Boy, Let's Go Down to the Sand. You know, so
oh, don't stop there.
I've had good times. You know, good fun, and those will continue. I just did a great tour around Australia. You were talking about that earlier on, the Whole Lot of Love show. And that was fabulous. I've never worked in state theatres before, but I worked in the state theatre, and all around Australia we did all the theatres. The Palais in St Kilda and the state theatre in Sydney, Wollongong, Wyoming. And gee, what a great experience that was. Playing our tribute, our homage to Led Zeppelin, one of my favourite rock bands, because they were so classy.
Love it. I've got a few of their songs I'll be playing.
You know,
they were
the classiest rock band, because their choruses, they didn't just sing a chorus over and over. In fact, they don't really have any choruses. Just like the formula of Stairway to Heaven. That never had a chorus.
It had
an end bit.
Sing it.
It had a bit. But that's the thing. They had bits.
Give me one of those bits.
Well, there's the, you know, there's a lady who's sure all that glitters is gold, and she's buying the stairway to heaven.
Wow.
I mean, that was one of my favourite all-time songs. We got a couple of people waiting to us outside the window here.
We have Mia, and that's her father, Sam, and I am going to have Mia on the show. We might call her in. I might just call her in. So, when we go to a song, we're going to call her in. Jimmy, you're a no-nonsense man, and I do believe you see right through people, and you can tell whether they're fake or real.
Oh, right. Who told you that?
I've done some research
on
you.
You're a funny guy. Oh, I think I'm a pretty intuitive person with guys and
What about
girls.
With females?
And girls, yeah.
Well, when you look at me into my eyes, what do you see?
A nutcase.
Yeah, okay, definitely there. All right, kidding. We'll move on from there.
You're beautiful, you know it.
I don't mind being called a nutcase. And also, you don't judge people. I have picked that up from somebody as well. And I want to ask if that stems from your background.
Yeah, look, it does, because my mum and dad always were, my mum and dad were singers, Irene and Jimmy Cupples. They were in the music business. Growing up in Williamstown, we come from Scotland, and they used to say to me, oh, you know, never judge a book by the cover. And also in the music business, other people used to rubbish other singers, you know.
Can you judge me?
The professional jealousy. And mum and dad would say, oh, I've heard some terrible things about that person. But then they would remind themselves to take that person as they meet them themselves. And I've always done that. And I've always been so surprised at the people that were made out to be terrible people have actually been the nicest ones.
Have I been made out to be a terrible person?
Yeah, and it's all true.
Okay.
No, you're a sweet, you're a sweetheart. You know it.
I know, I do actually.
That'll be $50.
I'll give you 100 if you keep saying it.
I'll say it again.
Now, there is also, I have done some further research, and there is also a heart in that soul of yours. Okay, and a more serious note. The poor. I have been told that you actually give a lot to the poor. You actually see people that are less fortunate and you help these people and you work for, you go and do jobs for charities. And another person told me that you're very weary of charities and you do your research first because there's a lot of shonky ones out there.
Yeah.
So how do you help the poor, Jimmy? What do you do for them?
Oh, you're a very sneaky little thing.
Oh, I've
you?
Got some deeper things, but I'll do it slowly.
How deep do you want to go?
I'll break you in slowly.
Oh, Jesus. goodness. I bumped into a guy that used to sing in a band called CDB, and they had a great song that was on the radio quite a long time ago called Let's Groove Tonight, Share the Spice of Life. And he's a great dancer and singer, Gary Pinto. And somebody said to me, he used to sometimes be a little bit late for things, meetings and stuff. And he'd say, oh, I just went down here and I just fed some homeless people. And it just resonated with me and it stuck with me that on my way to a gig, I'm so nervous about what's going to happen and what the night's going to unfold like that I'm not seeing the world around me. So I've started in the last few years doing that. I've done my charity, big charity work, sure, for children's hospitals and things for kids with cancer and stuff like that, and that's always a pleasure. But I've also gone into the streets and I've bought food and I've driven around and I've found people that were homeless. And
wow.
But I've done it in my own home area too, of Werribee. And if you've got a keen eye, you'll be very surprised at the people.
If you actually open your eyes out there, you'll be surprised at what you find.
If you've got an eye for it, it's quite amazing. And boy, once you open your eyes and you see how many poor buggers are living on the street. And look, this one, last person I met was about a month ago. And he has now gone into rehabilitation to get himself off drugs and things. And don't forget, we can't judge them because they go on to these things for a reason. Sometimes they've had very hard backgrounds.
You should never judge. That's exactly right. Very when you actually hard. Find out their backgrounds, you kind of, yeah.
When you do listen to the stories and you think, oh, my goodness, I'm really fortunate. And you know what? It doesn't take anything for me to grab a couple of nice sandwiches and put them in a bag and drop them off. It doesn't take anything to go down to, you know, McDonald's or something and just grab something like that. And give them, if you want to make it even easier for yourself. It's so easy to do that, you know. And it's doing something good. And that's the true feeling that you get in your heart from doing stuff like that for people is just the biggest reward. It's not necessarily singing on a telly show or getting a big clap at the end of the night and being put on a pedestal. It's little things like that. It's not hard to do those sorts of things for other human beings. So, you know, that's kind of where I think my life's heading in the future, that I'll probably end up doing more things like that because it's so rewarding.
For the community.
So rewarding, yeah.
Can you sing one, even just part of a song. Not Searching for the Sun.
No.
Something else.
Don't worry, be happy. That's an old funny song. Don't worry, be happy.
Give me another one.
Do you know that poor bugger committed suicide?
Did he?
Yeah, you know the song, the guy that wrote, "Don't worry, be happy." They told me he committed suicide. I don't know. People taking the mickey out of me. Did he really?
Oh, my goodness.
Yeah, I heard that.
Oh, my goodness.
And when I heard that, I thought, oh, my God. That's ironic.
There is a song that I like you singing, and you got me singing with you one day, Wild Thing.
Oh, God, all the rock songs.
Well, I love it. Go on.
Well, let's do a funky version. Wild Thing, you make my heart sing. You make everything so groovy. KK Rock Check.
I love it. Jimmy, thank you very much for coming to the KK Factor, Melbourne's newest radio station, Rhythmore 1656, at this old ground of yours, Oakleigh.
Well, you're doing a fantastic job here. You really, really are. And it's really good to see you. You're a good soul. You've got a good spirit. And you must be cold. You really need to put some clothes on.
I know. Just stop taking it off, okay? And on that note...